a farmer who would every year gather a harvest of potatoes that he's been growing over the seasons and months, and he would gather those potatoes and he would peel them, bag them, and then sell them. Well, one year he seemed to have an overabundance of potatoes, and so he said, with all the work that I need to get done, I need to hire some help. I need somebody to go ahead and to peel these potatoes for me. So he hired someone, and he told the new hired potato peeler, saying that I want you to peel these potatoes. Then I want you to sort them from small, medium to large. And I want this at least half of it done by the end of the day. And so by the end of the day, he returned to the barn, and the man was not even near halfway done. And so the farmer kind of chuckled and said, man, I didn't know potato peeling was such hard work. And he said, no, it's not the potato peeling. He goes, it's having to make all those decisions. I guess that's a farmer joke. But anybody else have that frustration? You know, you go to Walmart or any grocery store to get either a 5-pound or a 10-pound bag of potatoes, and you're trying to look inside the potato bag because you want to at least maybe get a few, you know, nice big ones, right? And boy, Angel gets on my case. Every time I come home with a bag of potatoes, oh, you didn't get a good kind. And it's like, well, I mean, there's only so much bags, you know, to grab. So I believe we all have had that frustration before. But the moral of that story is decisions. We all have to make a decision, right? Decisions, decisions, decisions. Some of the decisions that we make, we can probably relate with the potato sorter or the potato peeler. I mean, we don't like to make decisions at times. Having a hard time trying to figure out if this would be considered small or medium. I mean, he didn't want to make those decisions. He didn't want to upset the farmer. Well, we can probably relate to that sometimes when we have to make decisions, do we not? Sometimes we just don't like to have to make a certain kind of decision. But nevertheless, we have to make decisions every single day of our life, whether we like it or not. Some of the decisions are relatively unimportant. You know, what to wear the next day, you know, what to have for breakfast, and etc. On the other hand, some of the decisions we have to make are relatively important, very important. Others are much more important than some of those minute little decisions that we have to make on a daily basis. Such a decision about maybe what it is that I want to do in regards to my occupation or career. What career or occupation path do I want to take? That's a very major important decision, am I right? What about the decision on whom to marry? That's a very important decision, is it not? These decisions are very important because they have an impact on our lives. There is, however, no decision as important as the decision to serve the Lord. That decision not only affects us now, but it'll also affect us in the life to come. The text for our lesson is about decisions. Life-changing, eternity-changing decisions. To kind of give a little bit of a recap of Matthew chapter 6, Jesus is talking about the main idea, chapter 5, verse 20, having a righteousness that surpasses that of the scribes and Pharisees. And in chapter 6 and following to the remainder of the Sermon on the Mount, he is specifically referring to specific Christian righteous living that we do on a day-to-day basis. And so, in fact, he says that this righteousness that you are to have is a righteousness that does not want to be seen by men. Not to be noticed by men. Now, don't get us wrong. I mean, Jesus wants us to shine our lights before others so they may see our good works. But there's a difference between them seeing our good works and from wanting to be noticed by them. Big difference right there. Big difference. And so we then focused on those three major Jewish practices that were known to be the foundation of Judaism: almsgiving, prayer, and fasting. And so we spent almost probably about 4 weeks from Matthew chapter 6, verse 1 through 18. Well, finally we can go on. Go on to the next section. Even though the section is still talking about righteous living, here Jesus talks about a decision that he wants us to make. A decision in regards to the way that we see certain things with our eyes. Let's go ahead and just read the text for ourselves, and then we will get into the nitty-gritty of it. Beginning at verse 19, he says, "Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. The eye is the lamp of the body. So if your eye is healthy, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light in you is darkness, how great is the darkness? No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money." Or, King James readers, "cannot serve God and mammon." We'll talk about that when we get to that particular verse. Decisions, decisions, decisions. What decision to make? Well, first decision we have to make: material or eternal? This particular decision that Jesus wants us to make is, in fact, a very major decision. Because again, it not only affects us now, but it affects us in the life to come. First decision, he says, is material or eternal? Which of the two do you prefer? Which of the two will you choose? He encourages us, as far as not only just giving us the free will to choose, but he encourages us to make sure that we choose the right choice. He says, "Do not store or lay up treasures on earth." Not on earth, he says. We will lay up treasures somewhere without exception. This being the case, we need to give thought to where our treasures are being laid up. And so he encourages us, don't lay up the treasures on earth. These words were not intended to ban all possessions, because Paul wrote that God richly supplies us with all things to enjoy, 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 17. Neither was the passage given to prohibit provision for the future, because Solomon says that the ant who prepares itself for winter by storing up food is a wise ant. Proverbs chapter 6, verse 6 through 8. So he's not talking about planning or preparation. He's not talking about or any type of prohibition or ban on all possessions, period. What then was Jesus concerned about? The answer to that question is found in the words, "Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth." For yourselves. That is the key word. What Jesus forbids his followers is the selfish accumulation of goods, extravagant and luxurious living, the hard-heartedness which does not feel the colossal need of the world's underprivileged people, the foolish fantasy that a person's life consists in the abundance of his possessions, and the materialism which tethers our hearts to the earth. That is what he's talking about. Self-centered, self-absorbed, greedy, all about me, all what I want, all what I need type of lifestyle. Now, someone may be thinking, okay, well, preach on, Corey. Amen, I agree to that. You know, all those rich people with all their treasures, they need that message. They need to hear it. So preach it loud and clear. But now I know that message doesn't apply to me because, I mean, I don't have, you know, much treasures. Unlike these rich people that I see around me all the time. Well, it is true that the emphasis in our text is on physical treasures, but the application can still be applied to you and I. Middle class, lower class citizens. All of us have something that we treasure. Something materialistic that is important to us. It may be family members. How can family members be materialistic? Well, because we're made up of matter. Our bodies are made up of matter. We're made up of material. This body right here is going to die. It's going to be destroyed like every other material around us. So yeah, family members, they can be our material. Our home, our job, maybe perhaps a specific skill, physical strength, a good reputation, or almost anything. Our treasure is something that we love best. It is that which we most long to possess if it is not ours. And it is that which we must fear to lose if we already possess it. We want it if we don't possess it. And we fear to lose it if we already possess it. Now, there's nothing wrong in valuing and enjoying the kinds of things that are listed, but something is very wrong if these are the most important things to us, if our affections are centered on this earth. That is when it becomes a problem. In our text, Jesus gives us several reasons for us not to store up treasures on the earth. His first appeal is to the mind, to common sense. He says, "Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in to steal." In Jesus' day, a man's wealth might be invested in a variety of things. It may not just be, you know, coins or denarii or money, but it's in a variety of things. It could be clothing, it could be grain, precious metals, fragrant oils, and jewelry. All these could be and can be destroyed or stolen. The first destroyer that Jesus listed was the moth. Moths could destroy the ornate clothing so highly prized in the first century. Think of all the purple garments. Think of the rich young ruler who wore purple garments. Think of the beautiful purple garments that Lydia designed. Man, those were valuable. Purple, the color purple at that time, expressed royalty and richness. Imagine those clothes being completely eaten by moths. You think those people would be a little bit upset? Freaked out, going crazy over? Moths could destroy, yes, the most prized, precious, ornate type of clothing that you could imagine in the first century. And they can still do it even today. Moths lay eggs on clothes that are stored, and the eggs hatched into fabric-eating larvae. They eat away the clothes. So you know what I mean, that if you open up your closet and then you found a whole bunch of holes all over your nice jackets or your nice dresses and whatnot, you know what the problem is. It's either one of two reasons, one, mice or moth. And if you don't have mice problems, then your only conclusion would be, okay, I got moths. And now the horrible thing is that using mothballs, guess what happens to the clothes when you use mothballs? Stinks it up and you can't get the stink out. And so it's like, it's hopeless. You can't even wear it. That's why I say that to people, like, if you're going to be using mothballs on clothes to get rid of the moths and everything, what's the point of even keeping the clothes? You can't wear them anymore. You can't get the stench out. It's disgusting. It's destroyed then. It's destroyed. The second destroyer is the rust. Rust. Now, the word translated rust means an eating. That's what it means, an eating. It can be thought of as the eater in the noun sense. Normally, what's interesting is that when it's used in the noun, the eater, they normally use it in reference to mice and rats. The word can refer to rust that eats away at anything with iron content, or to corrosion that lowers the value of precious metals. And it could be included as mice or vermin that spoil stored up grain that you have. It can even be applied to worms that destroy growing crops. The eater, rust, it can destroy precious metal. Mice, vermin, eat away the grain. Worms can eat away the crops. All those valuable materialistic possessions, gone. The third destroyer that Jesus mentions is the thieves that break in and steal. Most houses in Palestine, during Jesus' day that is, were built of dry, sun-baked bricks. So even if the doors were locked or barred, a determined and desperate thief could still dig his way through the roof or through the side of the walls to get into the house and to steal all precious jewelry or any valuable ointments that they have, and it's gone. Someone may respond that, okay, well, I am thankful that is no longer the case here in the 21st century. Now, I spray for moths, again, I don't understand why, because now you just ruined all the other clothes, you can never wear them. So, might as well just go ahead and burn the clothes. You can't use them anymore, just burn them. But some people are determined. They're determined to still save those clothes. They're so valuable to them. So they spray for moths. They throw mothballs out there. They put out traps for vermins and for mice. And they have the latest security system to keep out thieves. But however, here's the thing. Even after having taken every precaution possible, it is still true that the things we own can make themselves wings and fly away, figuratively speaking. Proverbs chapter 23, verse 5. The list of potential wealth destroyers is almost endless. Well, how can they specifically develop wings and fly away according to Proverbs 23, verse 5? Well, think of these metaphors or these figures right here. Serious illness. Business reverses. About loss of jobs. Collapse of the economy. Look back at the Great Depression. Look back at the Great Recession that we went through not too long ago. What about the mishandling of funds? Natural disasters. Think of the lady in the family whose house got burned down. Lost a lot of possessions. Destroyed. Think about pandemics. What about wars? Tax increase. Leaders in our nation who don't know anything about having to save or spend money. I'll just put it that way. What about denied insurances? That's happened many times. Folks, the list could go on. Even if you are able to hold on to your possessions all your life, you will someday die, Hebrews 9:27, and will have to leave them all behind. Reminds me of a story about one man. As death approached, he converted all his wealth into diamonds and gold coins. He swallowed the diamonds and had the gold coins sewn onto his funeral coat that they put him on. His wealth went with him to the grave. but not to the life thereafter. John wrote that this world is passing away, 1 John chapter 2, verse 17. Anyone can look around and can see that that's no brainer. That's not rocket science. This world is passing away. We look at ourselves in the mirror and we see that we are just continuing to age. We're not getting any younger. You know, I turned 31 and I noticed that I'm already getting some of those little purple veins like right up here. It kind of freaked me out a little bit. Some of y'all thinking, oh, Corey, you're just a babe. Well, thank you. Thank you. I am still a baby. I mean, I still am a baby. I want to think that I'm still a baby. But eventually the fact of the matter is that this world is passing away and all the things in it. What's the point of making the decision to turn to materialism and throw away your eternal salvation? That is what Jesus' readers and followers, that's what he's wanting us to think. He wants us, we have the free will to choose. Yeah. And I've heard many, many parents that say that, oh, well, I mean, you know, I don't necessarily teach my kids certain things about the Bible every night, or they don't go to worship with me every Sunday because I want them to make choices for themselves. And if they don't want to hear anything about the Bible, I won't say anything. And if they don't feel like going Sunday morning, I will let them go. Well, guess what? You're encouraging them to make the wrong choice. It's good that you want them to make choices. I want anybody to force me or to hold me down and make me do something that I don't want to do. But here's the thing, as far as parents go, your job is to encourage your children to make the right choice. That is what Jesus is doing right here. He says, you have the free will to choose, but guess what? I'm going to encourage you and command you, really, that if you choose this, your end result's going to be this. But if you choose to follow my will, your end result is going to be this. That's why I command you to not store up treasures on the earth, because I want you to make the right choice, he says. Make the right decision. Make the right decision. Because those treasures that we store up here on earth will disappear. But in heaven, lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. In heaven, there are neither moths, nor rust, nor mice, nor vermin, nor worms, nor thieves. All deposits into the bank of heaven are secured eternally. Nobody can touch it. As Peter states in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 4, that we have an eternal inheritance which is imperishable and undefiled. It will not fade away, and it's reserved for you in heaven. And I love that Greek word for reserved that he uses. That word reserved there in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 4, is a word that was used for military guards who would march back and forth, back and forth. Figuratively, spiritually speaking, that is exactly what God is doing. He says, I am protecting your inheritance. I am guarding it. I am marching back and forth, watching over it. No one's going to take it from you. You have it in safe hands. You have it in the most safe of hands. The eternal Almighty God has it reserved for you and I. Choose the eternal over the material. Questions we must ask ourselves are, where is my heart? What is most important to me? Because the treasure is the location of our heart. Our heart and dedication is to do His will. And in doing so, we are depositing our treasure into our heavenly account. Think of the hours you spend in giving acts of kindness, verse 1 through 4 of Matthew 6. Think of the times that, in the hours that you spent in praying, verse 5 through 15 of Matthew 6. Think of the hours and time that you spend in fasting, verse 16 through 18. Could those hours be used to bring in big bucks in our earthly account? Yeah, it could. But which is more important to you? Which is more important to you? It is foolish to put our treasure in harm's way. If we are solely focused upon earthly gain, then we are exposing our treasure to being lost, stolen, and then what are we going to do? But the heavenly treasure, it is untouchable. It is guaranteed never to be lost. This is what the God-approved person does. This is what the person who has a righteousness that surpasses that of the scribes and Pharisees does on a day-to-day basis. He goes to worship, conduct Bible studies, gives acts of mercy, kindness. He prays continually. He goes on fasts, and the list goes on. Ladies, you meeting here an hour early before Wednesday night Bible study? To fill out cards to those who may be sick, to those who may we have not seen for worship service on Sunday morning? Guess what you're doing? Storing up treasures in heaven. Even though it may not bear much fruit, you're bearing a lot of fruit in your eternal account in heaven. Brother Ricky, going out and handing out food to people who are in need. Guess what you're doing, brother? Storing up treasures in heaven. Proud of you. Are we storing up treasures in heaven? As we put God first in all that we do, Matthew 6:33, we are storing up treasures in heaven. As we live the kind of lifestyle described on the Sermon on the Mount, we are storing up treasures in heaven. Jesus then gives a very interesting and unique metaphor. I love this metaphor. He says, the eye is the lamp of the body. So, if your eye is healthy, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light is in you, if then the light in you is darkness, how great is the darkness? So Jesus is still talking in the context about choosing material or eternal. And he uses this beautiful metaphor as an illustration in using light and darkness about how we see earthly treasures. He says the eye is the lamp of the body. The way you feel about things all begins with the way and the how you see things. How do you see treasures? How do you see them? Do you see them as earthly gain? Or do you see them as an opportunity to utilize them in order to gain your heavenly account? If your eye is healthy, your whole body will be full of light. Now, interestingly, the Greek word used for eye in verse 22 and 23 is the same Greek word used for seek in verse 32 and 33. Same Greek word. If your eye is clear, then you have a proper biblical view of material treasures. You see clearly for what it is, only as things to be utilized for the kingdom of God in order to store up heavenly treasures. But if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. And how great is that darkness, he says. You see treasures as in a selfish, self-centered, materialistic way, then your whole body is going to be full of darkness. He says, what's supposed to be viewed biblically, you chose to view selfishly. And how great is that darkness in your body now? Your eye is bad, and thus the whole body is full of darkness. If you do not have a proper respect of treasures, then you will not have a proper relationship in worship, marriage, work, friends, spouse, family, and etc. Well, how so? Think of the woman who becomes so desperate for money that she's willing to sell her own body out on the street in prostitution for it. Think about the man who gets a great high and adrenaline all throughout his body when he's winning at the tables. So far to the point that he ends up throwing all of his family's life saving on the table and loses it. That is how much darkness, that's how great the darkness is. That is the great darkness that we are talking about. So the question again, how do you see treasures? Do you see them as an opportunity, as a way for you to gain more in your heavenly account? Or a way to gain your earthly account? Which is it going to be? Material or eternal? Jesus says, I encourage you to choose the eternal. He then ends in verse 24 by saying, you either choose money or God. Now, I'll be honest, it was kind of very difficult trying to find the right pictures to visualize each point for this PowerPoint. Especially when you're trying to find one that's a picture of God, and you're like, well, I mean, how do I do that? And so, really, God's word is the best thing that I could find. So, either, what do you choose? Money or God? You've got to make a decision, and you cannot obey both of them. How amazing is it that Jesus says the opposite of God is money? Do you find that interesting? The opposite of God is money. Well, again, the overall context of what Jesus is speaking about is material. So it's either God or your materialistic possessions. Money is part of that materialistic possessions. Why Jesus specifically chose money? Great question. But he emphasizes why it is necessary to choose between God and money. At the beginning of verse 24, he says, no one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to one and despise the other. Now, someone may object, saying that, but a man can have two jobs, Corey, and work for two bosses. Well, Jesus is not referring to employees. Rather, he's referring to servants. The Greek word used here for servant means to be owned by one master. And men who work can work for two employers, but no slave can be the property of two masters. Single ownership and full-time service are the essence of slavery in the New Testament. Some have attempted to serve two masters. The Old Testament says that certain nations fear the Lord, but they also serve their idols. 2 Kings chapter 17, verse 41. Today, some are trying to serve the Lord on Sundays while devoting themselves entirely to the world the rest of the week. Jesus, however, spoke plainly on the matter. No one can serve two masters. Period. He says you only have two options. Money or God. Now, the word translated money is rendered mammon in the King James Version. Mammon is a Greek transliteration of an Aramaic word for wealth. In this passage, mammon, or money, is personified as a slave owner. Many a man is owned by that which he thinks he owns. It has been said that money is a good servant, but a harsh master. Perhaps you're reminded of someone whose every action seems controlled by money and what it will buy. But before you do that, I want us to make application to ourselves first. Remember what the challenge of the Sermon on the Mount is. Before making application to others, make it to yourselves first. Most of us have been guilty, to some extent, of allowing money to control our lives, perhaps without even realizing it. Now, it may not be money. Some may have a good balance of money, but what about other materialistic things? Perhaps, without even realizing it, there's some particular materialistic thing that has been controlling you. Notice that Jesus did not say that we should not serve God in money, but rather he says that we cannot serve God in money. It is an either-or situation. Either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to one and despise the other. Either or situation. Can't have it both. The devil uses wealth as a tool for his evil purposes, and he does not mind a divided heart. That is because the one who tries to serve God and wealth has in reality rejected God. God will not tolerate a divided heart. He said that I am the Lord. That is my name. I will not give my glory to another. Isaiah 42, verse 8. One person has stated, to be able to live a spiritual life in the midst of a material environment has been and is the perpetual problem of Christianity. I'd have to agree with that statement. Because our challenge as Christians is to be in the world and not of the world. John 17, verse 11 and verse 16, I believe. To choose God instead of worldly things. That's what it means to be in the world but not of the world. Choose God, not worldly things. When we do, then and only then, we can be salt of the earth and the light of the world. Matthew 5, 13 and 14. Decisions, decisions, decisions. Each of us has to make decisions all day, every day. As I said earlier, some are relatively unimportant, while others are of great importance. And of all the decisions we must make, none are more important than these: the material or eternal, money or God. If we have grasped the message of Matthew 16, verse 19 through 24, the decision should not be difficult to make. Who would not reject the worthless in order to receive the eternal valuable? Who would not choose to bow before a loving eternal Father rather than to serve the decaying things of this dying world? But nevertheless, all people over the world daily are making the wrong decisions. And it breaks our hearts, does it not? Many times I've had preachers that try to encourage me and lift me up to remind me, saying that, gotta remember, Corey, they're not rejecting you, they're rejecting God. True. But it breaks my heart that they're rejecting God. It does. We have got to make the right decision. Because when we do, then and only then we can be salt of the earth and light of the world and bring influence to a world that is filled with darkness and to help point them back to the right path. to help guide them into making the right choice before it is all too late. What about you? What's your decision going to be? Have you made that decision? Well, if not, right now, it's time to decide, together as we stand and as we sing.
Hark the gentle voice of Jesus falleth tenderly upon your ear, sweetest.